Good evening, everybody. Welcome to class number six on the Dispossessed. We are now firmly in the backstretch of this session. This seminar here on the Dispossessed. I am increasingly thinking we're probably going to need an extra week to finish this up, probably, but we'll see. I said last time I was kind of hoping to get to the temporal physics stuff. I'm not gonna do that this time. Next time, I hope we'll get to temporal physics. Good evening, everybody. Can everybody hear me? I want to make sure everyone is things are coming through okay. Okay, cool, excellent. Good. Yana says you're no longer getting the notification emails. Yeah, Yana, I stopped those because those seemed kind of useless, actually. If you like them, I can do them again, but they seemed to me a little, I was underwhelmed by the notification emails myself, but if it's handy, I'll start them back up again. Anyway, okay, no problem. Good to know. I thought them useless, but if you guys think them useful, then absolutely. I shall reinstate the notification emails. Excellent. Good to know. Thank you. Thank you for that. Of course, as you guys know, this the Dispossessed class here is the first time we're using this new interface, you know, steadily for an entire Mythgard Academy course here. So, always happy for feedback from you guys about what you think and what's good and what's not good. So, all right, cool. First, announcement. We are, of course, coming to the end at last. We started the Dispossessed, the day before the fall fundraising campaign began. We are now coming to the end of the fall fundraising campaign. This week is the final week. We are culminating on Saturday with the webathon, our annual webathon, which is always a really fun time. It's sort of the day in which we sort of feature everything about Signum, who we are. You know, we're going to have sessions from all of our programming and sort of all the way across. You know, we'll have a special Tolkien lecture by a member of our faculty, a lecture on Tolkien and alchemy, which should be really cool. We'll do a presentation by one of our students, one of our very first graduates, who is going to be presenting about her thesis topic, which is on it's on two of Tolkien's poems, or rather two versions of one of Tolkien's poems. It's on Luni and the Seabell are the poems in question. And specifically, she's really interested in Tolkien's use of traditional fairy motifs in his poems, and what we can see sort of about the development of his thought comparing those two poems. Really, really cool thesis. She's now, Penny Holdaway, who is the student in question, is now studying for her PhD with Dimitri Fimi over in Cardiff. So that'll be awesome. So we'll get a lecture from Sarah Brown in the Signum faculty. We'll get a thesis presentation from Penny Holdaway. We're going to do we're going to have a special trivia competition. We're going to do I'm going to do a special Lotro stream with my burglar Grifflet and some special guests, some people whose, not faces, but voices, possibly, some of you might recognize. And we're gonna do a special Mythgard Academy one-shot session on the Netflix series Stranger Things. I'm gonna be having a discussion with Brenton Dickinson, also in the Signum faculty, and we're gonna be talking about Stranger Things, which I'm really excited to talk about now. I have finally gotten a chance to finish the series, and I am really excited to talk about the way that I love the idea of the upside down, and especially, of course, the way in which it is connected with the boys' experience playing first edition Dungeons and Dragons. I found like my memory of first edition rules was kind of rusty. I mean, the biggest question I emerged from at the end of the first episode, right? I was like, why was he rolling a d20 when he was attacking with a fireball? That doesn't make sense. Like, the Demogorgon should be making a saving throw. But I'm like, maybe I'm misremembering. It's been so long since I played first edition. I don't know. Anyway, so it's going to be fun. We're going to talk about Stranger Things. We're going to do a special, I've got a special, basically a special Tolkien professor episode, where I'm going to be doing a Silmarillion discussion, with a couple of very young and enthusiastic fans, Maggie and Sophie, who are ages 11 and 9, I think. And they have a long series of Silmarillion questions that they're going to grill me with. So this is sort of a couple middle schoolers putting me on the spot and see if I can answer their questions about the Silmarillion. It's going to be a really great session. And then after that, we'll have a long film session, where we're gonna get together the film exec team, me, Dave, and Trish, and we're gonna get together with the script team. And we're going to talk about the frame and work out map out the whole frame for season two. So anyway, the whole day, it's going to start at 11 a.m. Eastern time and go until 9 p.m. No, the last session, yeah, probably will end at 9-ish, maybe a little bit later, 9 p.m.-ish. So it'll be about 10 hours of broadcast. We're going to have special tutorials, as I said, sort of video, special videos. We're going to have trivia throughout the day. There's going to be prizes and giveaways and special auctions. And of course, as I say, the culmination of our fundraising campaign for the year. We've already raised over $28,000 towards our annual fund. Our annual fund goal this year is $50,000 for the whole year, which stretches through July 31st to keep Signum running for the whole year. As you see, we're already over halfway towards our whole annual goal, which is wonderful. We'd like to get even closer to it by the end of the webathon. If you haven't had a chance to give to support Signum University and our programs yet, of course, that would be a wonderful opportunity, and there'll be a bunch, as I say, a bunch of prizes and giveaways associated with that as well, including one of the prizes is going to be signed copies of the debut novel of one of our Signum students, actually, which is really cool. So anyhow, lots of really fun stuff that we're going to be doing. And again, this is all this coming Saturday, the 29th of October, starting at 11 a.m. Eastern time. So, you can go to Arthur, Patricia Minger is the student, and her novel is called The Magic Flute. So anyway, I've just been learning about that recently, and I'm very excited for her. Okay, so here, let me just so give you two links to those of you who are here live with us. This is the link for the webathon itself, so you can see the full schedule. There are several different links that we're going to be using throughout the day, for different sessions and things, so you can find all that stuff there. And of course, this is the link for the donations if you haven't donated yet. So Jordan Sunderland asks, when does the Return of the Shadow quest start? Jordan, being a little previous there, the voting is still ongoing. Don't try to bias things here. It is true that the Return of the Shadow is likely to be one of the finalists. I understand that there seems to be a movement in that direction, but there are several other finalists which are sort of rising to the top there. So we'll see what we need to let the democratic process work its way out. Jordan, I agree. I think the odds are fairly good. That does seem right. And Jordan, really, of course, the answer to your question is it depends on exactly when this ends. Of course, this is week six. I'd originally planned 8 weeks. That is two more sessions after this. As we'll see, maybe I will do that. That's possible that I will achieve that goal. I'm not going to rule that out yet, but it is also possible that I will want a ninth week at the end of this. So that'll take us into what if we do a ninth week, that'll take us almost to Thanksgiving. So I'm thinking, Jordan, most likely the next Mythgard Academy session, whatsoever text it may be that we end up discussing, is likely to be like the beginning of December, basically right after American Thanksgiving, I think is it seems to me the likeliest time. Nancy asked, when will we find out? Oh, about the next book, right? When will the suspense be over, right? All the tension and the drama of this election. It will be, we'll find out soon-ish, but I think in this next week, actually. I'm trying to remember if anyone recalls. I think the in his emails, Ed Powell, the White Wizard, Chief of the White Council, has I think he mentioned, I'm forgetting now the date that he mentioned, the cutoff date for voting. So, or the winning is almost done and the voting will be open soon. So yeah, it's going to be probably next week. By the end of next week, I would think we'd be able to make the official announcement. So yeah, exactly. Okay, yeah, and no, I'm not going to be baited to talk about the American presidential election at all. In fact, on my daily life, you would be hard pressed to be able to prove that I'm even aware of the fact that there's a presidential election going on. I don't think about it. I'm not going to be drawn into. I'm not going to be drawn into talking about it. Anyway, okay, cool. All right. So let's jump back into the Dispossessed. I want to start. Okay, so this is. Let me say a couple things about sort of where we're starting off here. First, I want to start off with this conversation with Vale, and there are kind of two things that I want to look at here. The kind of big picture that I'm wanting to examine today is sort of the political reality of the situation, not just the situation in Uris, but on Anaris. We've been looking at the really kind of complicated place that that Le Guin has put us over the course of reading this book. We've talked about this quite a bit, right? How on the one hand, it's easy to kind of read it and be like, Uris is awful, and it's sort of like a slightly exaggerated caricature of our society, and therefore sort of an indictment of modern capitalism and our many of the hang-ups that our society has and everything, this sort of pain of praise for Anaris and the kind of the particular kind of sort of communism that that they have there on Anaris. I mean, I can totally understand anybody who comes away from the book with that reading, but as we've discussed, that's not really a fully satisfactory reading as well. And there have been lots of times through the story when we have I been invited at least to see some criticism. We've been looking at, from the beginning, we've been looking at the kind of hypocrisy that is seems to be endemic on Anaris. And Shevik's increasingly sort of fraught relationship with his own society, right? Not because he's becoming disenchanted with Odonianism, but because he is a faithful Odonian and is forced to confront more and more how Odonianism, the Anaresti society is in fact imperfectly Odonian, to which is kind of another statement in some ways. And so, so that it's not that I in the end, as I've said, I think that that idea of like, like Anaris good, Uris bad. Is pretty clearly a serious oversimplification of this story. I mean, I think briefly of the comment that Shevik makes it internally when he goes to the slum, right, for the first time, and he's seeing this, and there's that temptation. He has this temptation to call it the real Uris, right? That he's now that he's finally seeing where the lower class live, and knowing this is real, right? This is what's real here in Uris, that all that other, the fancy, rich, comfortable, beautiful Uris is is this facade, right? And now he's coming to the real Uris. That's his first impulse to say that, but he immediately corrects it and says, no, the beautiful part is real too, right? I mean, that's also Uris. Uris is both of these things. And so if you want to see the reality of Uris, you have to confront both sides. And I think that's, we don't see that spelled out for us as clearly, with an Aris, right? And yet I think we can see a similar kind of thing, right? I mean, there's no question that, sort of the principles of Odonianism are being held up as good things here. And yet, there's both sides of Anaresti society, both the ways in which they have embraced Odonianism and the ways in which they have not, or have slipped away from it. That's also the real Inaris as well. So, in our first, well, actually, through most of the class tonight, we're going to be looking at that a little bit more. We're going to be looking at, I'm going to be focusing primarily on Shevik in Urus today, looking at a couple different chapters, both mostly chapter 7 and 9. Chapter 7 is the one, if I'm remembering correctly, the one where he has his outing with Vea, which ends so horribly at her party, right? And him passing out drunk, and then it after horrible things, and then it and then chapter 9 is the one where he actually goes and joins the strike, the revolution, and finds the lower classes, right? And participates in the march, which also ends horribly, but in a different way. So, those are the two chapters we're going to really focus on tonight. And I want to begin because in these chapters, well, as usual, lots of stuff happens, but the things that I really want to focus on are the way in which our own kind of understanding of the situation, our own really our own grasp of terminology in some sense, is kind of challenged or developed, or both things happen, I guess. Anyway, that's what we're going to be doing. But there's this other thing that's going to come up and that I don't want to, I feel like it would be both cowardly and irresponsible to ignore, and that is the far more sort of personal issue with Vea. And Vea is a very disturbing character in a lot of ways. And certainly the sexual assault that happens at the end of chapter 7 is disturbing, right? And when I was thinking about class and preparing for class, there was a little part of me that wanted to just sort of avoid, not avoid it, well, yes, avoid it. There's a part of me that wanted to avoid it and just not go there because it's such a sensitive subject and so difficult. That is so difficult to talk about in sort of rationally in a lot of ways. But of course, well, first of all, Le Guin doesn't really permit me to do that. At least I don't think you can avoid it, because it's pretty forceful. And yeah, Nancy, I did of course mean Shevik being disturbing, but I think Vea is disturbing too, just in different ways. And the whole depiction of Vea is disturbing. There's a, it's a disturbing scene, and I use that word carefully. It's not, I mean, it's not just me. I think, I mean, this is not just like my own personal issues, right? Me being disturbed about this. Shevik is disturbed. Like everybody's disturbed. It's disturbing, right? Everyone, the whole equilibrium of things is disturbed there, right? Anyway, okay, all right. So, like I said, I would have been tempted perhaps to avoid that. I don't want to avoid that. I guess apart from the fact that, as I say, Le Guin really won't let me because all of the passages wherein it's discussed are not really passages I can skip if I want to talk. I could have just been like, no, let's talk about the larger political issues, right, and not deal with this really fraught and disturbing sexual issue, but sex and gender issue really. But I again, first we can't because all the passages that talk about the sex and gender issue are centrally important also to the larger sort of political theory question. But also, I just, as I said, I think it would be both cowardly and irresponsible to skip it. So I'm not gonna. But again, talking about this story, the thing that it's the simultaneity thing, right? The way that all of these themes and ideas are all woven in together. I have found In planning the slides for this class, like which passages do I want to talk about and what order do I want to talk about those passages, the Dispossessed has been the hardest to put them in a sequence where I'm going to go through, right? So, to have this like Sibuyan, what do we say? Sibobian? Wasn't that the adjective we decided? Anyway, to make it a linear sequence, right, where I'm proceeding from slide to slide, when of course we have simultaneous sequencing and simultaneity in ideas and as well as in narrative procedure in this book, it's been almost impossible to try to plan out how to talk about this stuff. And this class, more than any of them, because of the way that the political stuff and the sort of sexual and gender dynamic stuff overlap and are articulated at the same time and in the same scenes, made it really impossible. So what I'm gonna try to do is I'm gonna ask you to bear with me. I can't kind of pull out the passages and talk about them in two different sequences at the same time. So what I'm gonna have to do is basically I'm gonna try to kind of demarcate when I'm talking about one and when I'm talking about the other, which means if you make comments, I'm going to be kind of selective because I'm going to try to stay focused. I'm going to try not to talk about both topics at exactly the same time because I suspect that that would quickly become nonsense. But so I'm going to probably come back and revisit some of these passages later on. Anyway, we'll see how it goes. But I just didn't want you to think. When I'm looking, because especially the first couple passages are going to be about like how sexy Vea is, and I want to focus first on the sort of the political implications and the larger thing. We might notice some things in passing, but I don't want you to think I'm just skipping over it. I'm going to come back to it, and we'll get there. Okay, all right. With no further ado, let's get to the woman in the table. All right. He sat down by her. A phrase Takfer used came into his mind as he looked at Vea's slender feet, decorated with little white shoes on very high heels. A body profiteer, Takfer called women who used their sexuality as a weapon in a power struggle with men. To look at her, Vea was the body profiteer to end them all. Shoes, clothes, cosmetics, jewels, gestures, everything about her asserted provocation. She was so elaborately and ostentatiously a female body that she seemed scarcely to be a human being. She incarnated all the sexuality the Iyati repressed into their dreams, their novels and poetry, their endless paintings of female nudes, their music, their architecture, with its curves and domes, their candies, their baths, their mattresses. She was the woman in the table. Okay. All right. What do you notice? What do you notice here? First of all, remember the observations that we made of the first path, the passage that is being explicitly alluded to there from way back in chapter one when he was first on the Iyati spaceship, right? And he was noticing there's the comment about the mattress, right? How comfortable it was, and how he found the experience of lying in the bed itself, just like feeling the mattress, sort of disturbingly erotic, sort of distinctly erotic. And this idea of like the woman in the table. Do you remember? So quiz now. What did Shevik speculate? What speculation did he have about Iyari society, based on his observation of the furniture on board the spaceship? You remember? Yeah, exactly. Good. Nancy and Karita recall, of course, the celibate cabinet makers, James Stevens as well. Absolutely. So notice his. I think it's very significant that when he was noticing these things, he wasn't thinking about women. That is, he attributed this sexual dynamic, right? He attributed that to the men. Right, it said something about Iyati men, that there was a woman in the table. Right, it didn't say anything about women, in his mind. right? Or he didn't, it didn't lead him to any assumptions or conclusions about Ayati women, only about Ayati men, right? And part of this, it seems that, you know, he's coming into this, of course, with a general understanding, right? Perhaps not an intuitive understanding, but a general acknowledgement of the fact that the Ayati are like repress their sexual desires, right? And so, you know, this concept that, you know, as he articulates here, or as the narrator anyway on his behalf articulates here, talking about the sexuality the Ayati repressed into their dreams, novels, poetry, paintings, music, architecture, candies, baths, and mattresses. So he again he this is so that's a masculine thing, right? This is something that is a consequence for the men, from the men in Ayati society, again, according to his initial thing. But now that he's actually confronted by an Ayati woman, and remember, this was a thing that he didn't understand, right? He's been asking about women. He's had very little contact with women. Because of course none of the women are scientists, and so he mostly is hanging out with the other scientists at the university. So he doesn't get to, so this is really the you know, apart from, of course, when he first met Vea, at her brother Oye's house, he you know, he didn't have any real interact, we never saw him interacting at all with any females on Uros. So now that he is really observing her, the first thing he thinks back right away to the woman in the table. And yet now it comes up in a totally different context. Now he's making observations not about the men, right? It's not like, ah, we now see what the sexual repression has done to the men, right? Now it's also about the women, right? Sarah Lagarde points out that as far as we've gone, we never see the husband of this body profiteer. Sarah, we never will. The husband, Vea's husband, will always be off stage. He's a theoretical concept, right? She is presumably partnered. Yep, she mentions it. It's from all that she says, and I didn't quote that passage for us to look at, but Vea does mention her husband, and that he's away, and that he spends a lot of his time away. It seems to be a situation of convenience, and you'll recall that she doesn't seem to actually have any objections to having sex with Shevik. She's open to that, so long as the proper precautions and preparations are made. Arrangements must be made, right, in advance. Both contraceptive arrangements, clearly, is one of the main things she emphasizes, of course. But yes, in other words, there doesn't seem to be, she does, you know, she does not seem to be have like any objections to copulating with him, to use the Anaresti phrase, right? But yeah, she is married, but that doesn't seem to be a big issue for her. Veronica says, we cannot tell whether the woman is being intentionally provocative or Shevik is over-sexualizing her. Yes, and Veronica, remember we asked that question back in chapter one, right? When he was looking, when he was like touching the table and being like, this is erotic. And we were asking the question like, okay, does this tell us more about Ayati furniture makers or does it tell us more about Shevik, right? But he himself was acknowledging that. You'll recall from back in chapter one. You know, he was like, he thinks he knows himself well enough to know that, you know, his own, like, you know, he's been apart from Takfir, his partner, now for like several weeks, but he's like, I don't think it's me, right? You know, he was arguing, in a sense, that it was, that it definitely wasn't him, Veronica, right? But of course, that was a question that we were asking, right? And Veronica, I think you're very right to ask that question here again, right? Obviously, I mean, Shevik has been very, very strongly sexually attracted to Vea from their very first meeting at Oye's house. That was extremely clear, right? So it's I mean, he's everything about her asserted provocation, we're told. It's possible, of course, that that's just him. That's, or at least, to say it another way, Veronica, that says more about him than it says about her, right? It's possible. I don't think so, though. Or rather, I think if we insist, if we come away with that, how would I say it? I think that we as readers would have to be very stubborn to insist on that reading exclusively, if you see what I mean. They as speech, they as dress, even the most dispassionate description of her, the way that she dresses, the way that she talks, the way that she carries herself, sounds provocative. I mean, I'm like, everything about her asserted provocation seems to me, I mean, maybe you could argue that it's exaggerated, but it's not all him. I can't believe that. I am willing to believe that we're kind of getting this with that we that it's important that we're to remember that we're getting this through Shevik's filter, and his desire may be coloring his own reaction to her, his own reading of her. But again, I think we'd have to be we'd have to really have our we'd have to really have the bit in our teeth to insist on that was the that she is not at all provocative and it's all him. James, yeah, she is like the women in the films that Shevik watched when he was young. He recalls that, right? He remembers that. This is the thing. Yana, he does get drunk, but he's not drunk yet. This is when they're still out, I believe, if I'm remembering correctly, this bit of the conversation, this is the conversation that happens while they're out in the park together. So this is long before he's had any alcohol. And that's important. And I wanna make sure that we think about the significance of Shevik's inebriation, which I think is a really important thing in several ways, at the end of this chapter. But it's not in effect yet. Now, Rachel, I agree that's a really important point. According to Shevik, Rachel says she is the quintessential Iyati woman, so much so that she ceases to be human. Yes, it's interesting to me, Rachel. You're taking two observations and you're combining them, right? A, that he sees her as the, in his eyes, she's the quintessential Iyati woman. Even picking back up, as James was just saying, on those films, right? Like the horror films of how awful Urus is, right? That they were shown when they were kids. So that's yes. So there's that, Rachel. And then the second point that you make is about how she ceases to be human, right? Now, that's not the way the reasoning goes in the passage, right? That is, when he talks about her scarcely being human, it's not that she is so like she so fully fulfills the anti-Urasti, Anaresti propaganda that she ceases to be human. Her ceasing to be human is explicitly connected to her sexual provocation, right? She was so elaborately and ostentatiously a female body that she seemed scarcely to be a human being, right? Like he can't even remember he's wanted to interact with women as equals. And it's one of the things that we have seen him differing with Urasti men about from the beginning, from the doctor on the spaceship, right? Through the physicists and everybody, he takes for granted interacting with women as intellectual equals, right? So when he characterizes her as scarcely a human being, he's basically suggests she is sort of so much attention is being drawn to her body, right? She is so ostentatiously a female body. She is so ostentatiously an object of desire that she seems scarcely to be a human being. Like it's hard for him to interact with her in the ways that we see him interacting with women in Inaris, and I don't think we have much reason to doubt. I might be wrong about this, but I don't think we have much reason to doubt that Shevik's convictions about that are quite genuine. I don't think Shevik is hypocritical, like broadly hypocritical, I mean, about how he interacts with women and the assumptions that he makes about women. But anyway, Rachel, I want to come back to the point you made because I'm not just trying to say that you made a mistake or to call you out. I really like the connection that you're making. So I wanted to first observe that the way that you said it isn't exactly the way that it goes in the passage, but I like that as a sort of conclusion, right? Or a sort of an elaboration. Because she was so elaborately and ostentatiously a female body that she seems scarcely to be a human being. Rachel, I think it is fair to say, but that being ostentatiously a female body, being ostent and therefore in this context, that clearly means an object of desire. And I place the emphasis on the word object, right? That's what I understand him to mean when he says it's like it's hard to treat her like a human being because everything about her screams, I am an object of desire, right? I want you to make of me an object. I want you to view me as an object of desire. But that, Rachel, as I took you as suggesting, and I think that really works, that is the eotic ideal, right? I mean, that's what it means to be the quintessential eotic woman, right? Because one of the things that Shevek has been trying to figure out from the beginning of his time in Uris, right, is what do the women do, right? I mean, what they where are they? What are they up to, right? I mean, you don't let them be scientists, so what do they do? Could I meet one, right? And remember, and when he starts talking about women, you'll remember that his fellow physicists assume that he's looking for a sexual object, right? Oh yeah, don't worry about that. We can hook you up, they say, right? Not in those words, but right. In other words, they assume. Rachel, as you suggest, it's the quintessential Iotti way of looking at women, right? Not as peers, not as actors, not as fellow human beings, but as objects of desire, as possessions, right? The masculine view of women in Iotti society is obviously propertarian, right? Okay, so then I come back to where is Vea in all that? What do we get from there? By the way, one thing that interests me, and I take this as a natural consequence of the complexity of this book. The comments that you guys are making tonight are really long. Some of you are typing in really short comments, as you usually do. Many of you, even very experienced Mythgard Academy people, are typing in like five. I'm getting like 5-line comments, which of course, in general is very hard for me to read. I know both for those of you who are watching live and for those who are watching and listening to the recording, me sitting here going as I read your long comment is not real exciting. So it's much easier for me to interact with them if they're really short. But I get it, and I totally sympathize. It's really, really hard to work all this stuff out. So it's just a little trend I've been noticing here, that the comments not only are fat, but are getting fatter and fatter as the class goes on. It's tough. Yeah, good. Now, let's see. Tom Hillman was pointing out that talk fair. So back to Tom, thank you for bringing us back to Takfer's observation, which I think is a really important one, right? Her phrase of the body profiteer, right? Now, that phrase by itself actually is kind of interesting. Profiteer is, of course, one of those words that is used about, sort of used scathingly of Erasti society on Anaris. But it's not the number one, right? Propertarian is the big one, right? That's the one that we. But notice, what's the difference between propertarian and profiteer? They're related, obviously, right? Both of them are tend to be applied to the Erasti, but what's the difference? When you call somebody a propertarian, what are you saying about them? When you call them a profiteer, what exactly are you saying about them? Good. Jennifer, what a wonderful summation that is. Several of you are making really good comments about that. Jennifer says a profiteer is one who seeks profit, right? Who's trying to get something for themselves, and a propertarian is one who asserts ownership. Yes. Yes. Again, clearly closely related, right? But if someone is being called proprietarian, that's somebody who's basically saying mine, right? This is mine and you can't have it and I won't share, right? A profiteer talks about, as one of you says, Brian Dimmick said, talks about motive, right? It's not just a description of your attitude, this possessive attitude, right? Obviously, you have to have a fundamentally proprietarian point of view in order to be a profiteer, right? You're trying to get things for yourself. But it's profiteers is about means and ends, right? You are out to get something. So for instance, remember the language that Shevik used about he came to Urus to bargain, right? In as much as he is bargaining, he's being a profiteer, right? Not a proprietarian exactly, but a profiteer, right? Okay, good. All right, let's okay. I'm going back now. Tom's comment, that's where I was. So Tom says, Tom points out, he not only just refers us back to the body profiteer. Okay, hang on a second. Okay, Tom, I totally am coming back to your talk, but let me finish my train of thought about profiteer, why I asked the profiteer versus proprietarian question. Because it's interesting to me that it's the word profiteer, not proprietarian, that Tocqueville brings up. It's about motive, right? It's not just the attitude, this female attitude that Tocqueville is describing, and she's explicitly, it's explicitly a woman thing. That talked. I mean, is it possible that men on Anaris can be body profiteers? Possibly, theoretically, but that's not what Tocqueville is talking about. She's explicitly talking about women who have this particular attitude, right? They're not body proprietarians, right? It's not a possession thing of their bodies. It's the use of their bodies as a means to an end, and that end being personal gain, right? Trying to gain power. So it is proprietarian, but it's not just proprietarian simply, right? The claim of ownership of things. It is the manipulation or use of a particular means in order to gain power and possession for yourself, right? That's what she's accusing these women of doing. So women who use their sexuality as a weapon in a power struggle with men, according to Tocqueville's definition, are body profiteers, right? But what now, Tom, I'm coming back to your comment. What Tom pointed out is that the phenomenon of male-female power struggle obviously exists on Anaris in order for Tocqueville to have this definition, right? In order for it to have this phrase at all, right? This is a thing on Anaris. So we talked about, Rachel, you were suggesting that this provocation, right? This extreme provocation, the ostentatiously female body, right? The making of herself into an object of desire, such that she ceases almost to be human, or it's hard to consider her human. Rachel, you were arguing that that's the quintessential Iyadi woman, right? That's the concept anyway of the quintessential Iyadi woman. But clearly, it's not unknown in Anaris either, right? It's not like this in Anaris. And of course, this is one of the things that's kind of at stake in that whole conversation. And I couldn't quote the whole conversation, but the whole conversation that Vea and Shevik are having. Remember when they're debating about like whether Anaresti women would like it, right? Where Vea's like, oh, give them a bath and a depilation and some jewels and some nice dresses, right? They'd love it, right? They'd love it. And he's like, no, Anaresti women wouldn't like it, and neither would the men. And she's like, oh, honey, you would, right? Both of you would. That's kind of what's at stake here, right? Is it really, how deep into the culture is it? Did this Tocqueville suggests she has a disdain for this whole idea, right? As expressed anyway in that phrase. Though, do you remember how we're first introduced to Tocqueville? Okay, that's a really obscure question. Totally unfair. Do you remember where we first meet Talk Fair? This is particularly tricky because exactly Jennifer Shevick doesn't remember either. We don't even get her name. We're never introduced to her by name. We only find out later that that was her at the party, his going away party at the Institute, right? Exactly, the going away party person. But Neil, she's the going away party person, as James Stevens recalls, with the short hair, right? Now, why do I emphasize that? They talk about that. And she, and he, when Shevik finally remembers her, right, at the, in the get together that ultimately leads to the conversation where they decide to be partners, he recalls, he says, "You wore your hair short then." And she admits that she did that because she wanted to be noticed. Right. She cut her hair short on purpose because she wanted to get noticed, and she even implies that she was trying to catch his notice. So it seems, if I'm understanding those passages properly, that she was trying to catch Shevik's eye back then at the Institute, which didn't work right away, but eventually works. Right now, Takvir cutting her hair short to try to stand out so that Shevik notices her. It's not exactly a body prophecy, right? I mean, she is nowhere near Vea's league, right? And even comparing those two things seems totally unfair. But it's not apples to oranges, right? And so anyway, Tom, I'm just coming back to your point. Obviously, it's a thing on Inaris as well, right? This concept is a thing, or else Talkfair wouldn't even have a phrase for it. And that seems to me to be, I mean, it kind of makes me want to go back to the stuff we were talking about last time about human nature, right? How we do see this, there is a kind of a baseline, even thinking about the whole Setian concept and the likeness, ultimately the fact that the Anarasti and Erasti are brothers, right? Shevik came wanting to assert brotherhood with the, Inaris and Urus should be brothers, right? Well, but if they're brothers, then they're not different from each other, not totally different from each other, right? They have the same, they've been brought up in different cultures, but they've come from the same tree. And I think that we can, we can think we looked at that some last time as well. Okay. Now, Nancy, you make a wonderful observation. And for those of you who think we're on pace to do two passages tonight, don't despair. We have a lot of terms we're trying to establish here, and it's totally going to be relevant. It's going to make some of the other passages fly right by, I promise. But Nancy makes a really important point about Vea's provocativeness. And Nancy, you made this observation a while back. I believe it was in the context of when we were talking about is it Shevik or is it her, right? Is this a is this ostentatious female body, so is it telling us something about Vea, or is it telling us something about Shevik? I think that was the context, Nancy, in which you mentioned this. You'll correct me if I'm wrong, but she says that this, we get a strong impression that this is how gender works in Erasti society. This is how someone like Vea gets along in her culture. The provocation isn't personal. And I agree with you, Nancy. I don't think we are at all supposed to be taking from this the idea that she is specifically attracted to Shevik or that she is attempting to seduce Shevik. She probably is. She's a government spy, just like all the rest of them are, right? But that's not the point, even really. It does seem this is just how she is, right? Her behavior isn't about attracting him. It's not personal, right? It's not about him. It's who she is. It's what she does. And again, Rachel, coming back to the juxtaposition that you were making, it seems therefore to me to suggest this is what it means to be an Ayati woman. Vea is not just like an extreme over-the-top example of an Erasti woman, at least an Erasti woman of the propertied class. She is like the ultimate example, right? She seems to be representative. Good. Good. Okay. Sorry, going back. So many comments I don't have time for. Yes, Karita, I agree with you. Karita says she wonders if Vea's use of her power, an attractive body, is her making the most of the tools at her disposal. Yes, and I'm going to seize upon that, Karita, as brace yourself, a transition to slide number two. This is Shevik sort of probing, right, about her attitude to he's finally he's able to get the woman's point of view, right? What do the women think about Urasti society? And you too are self-content? You too, like the men, right? Indeed I am, Vea says. I don't believe it. Because it doesn't fit your principles. Men always have theories and things always have to fit them. No, not because of theories. Because I can see that you are not content, that you are restless, unsatisfied, dangerous. Dangerous! Vea laughed radiantly. What an utterly marvelous compliment. Why am I dangerous, Shevik? Why, because you know that in the eyes of men you are a thing owned, bought, sold, and so you think only of tricking the owners, of getting revenge. She put her small hand deliberately on his mouth. Hush, she said. I know you don't intend to be vulgar. I forgive you, but that's quite enough. Sorry, people. I'm laughing at people laughing at me for actually transitioning to. I'm at the cheers of encouragement I'm getting from people for actually moving on to slide number two. Nancy points out how swiftly Shevik's observations go from a marvelous compliment to vulgarity. Yes, and of course, Nancy, the thing that I would assert, right? The thing that I would assert here is that Shevik is attempting to do neither, right? I don't see Shevik's words here at all being reactionary in one way or another, right? He's not flirting with her. I don't think he, well, again, obviously he desires her. I do not believe he intends to be flirtation, that he's trying to compliment her in some way, nor that he's trying to shock her, right? He is merely stating what seemed to him to be the obvious facts, right? This is how this corrupt proprietarian system does this to be. You are marginalized, right? You are a slave. You are not free. You are owned. You are possessed. That's terrible. Therefore, we see how he understands not just her provocativeness, like that is not merely that, because notice his implication here seems to me to be pretty clearly that she is very complicit in the provocativeness, right? It's not just, not only is it not just him, it's not just the men, right? It's her. She is playing up to it, right? And so he interprets that. Right, he calls her dangerous because he assumes that her position is ultimately something like a revolutionary one. Right, of course he does. That's what Odonianism is all about. Right, so okay, so since you are marginalized, notice he comes into this. Although Vea is the most flamboyantly propertied class person that we meet in the entire book, right? Even Atro, old, kindly, aristocratic Atro, is not more ostentatiously, to borrow the word from the previous slide, is not more ostentatiously upper class, right? More upper, ostentatiously Urasti establishment than Vea, right? She is the one who everything about what she does, says, dresses, acts, says wealth. Right, and yet he comes to her assuming that basically she has more in common with the servants and the lower classes, the unpropertied classes, than she has with the men, right? Because the men marginalize her just as they marginalize them. She is possessed just as the servants are possessed. She is as much a slave as they are slaves. That seems to be his attitude, right? His perception. And so therefore, and I think we see that coming out here when he calls her dangerous, right? And he's saying the same thing both times, the thing that she takes as a compliment the first time and as a vulgarity the second time. He's saying the same thing both times, right? You are acting in a particular way in response to your situation. Your situation is that you are possessed. You are marginalized and powerless because you have no rights. You're owned, right? But yet you are acting consciously in these particular ways and in profiteering ways, right? She's a body profiteer, the body profiteer to end all profiteering, right? Therefore, she's trying to get something. So he says, obviously, she must be manipulating the system in order, in a sense, to undermine it, right? And what would lead her to do that? Restlessness, dissatisfaction, right? And because she sort of must, he assumes, be both restless and unsatisfied, she's dangerous, right? And it's when he spells that out more. You think only of tricking the owners, of getting revenge. That's what he was suggesting before, right? When he says that, though, it's vulgar, right? Jennifer says this is why she's identified as a profiteer rather than a proprietarian. Exactly, Jennifer, because she's wealthy, so she owns stuff, right? And remember, there's even that passage where her own wealth is emphasized, right? When she talks about her caterer and her party and all the, he really emphasizes all those possessive pronouns she uses. But yes, Jennifer, at the end of the day, she is herself owned, right? She is herself an object that is owned. So she is more of a profiteer than a proprietarian in that sense. Okay. What else? I'm looking at your Tom says the betting is heavy against reaching slide five now. Well, all right, Tom. We'll see. I'm gonna accelerate. You guys are gonna be shocked. Yeah, wait till you see. I'm gonna say 10, but we'll see. Yeah. Karita asks very sensibly, what does he expect she'll say? Yes, I'm considered a second-tier human and I'm miserable about it. Well, I mean, that's what the laborers say. That's what he finally gets Ifor to say, the servant, right, his man, in chapter 9. Though remember that took some coaxing, right? He the servant seemed to get offended when Shevik tried to talk to him, right? The thing that interests me is that she, well, okay, one of the things that interests me here is that she is flattered at being called dangerous, right? That's a flattering thing. But she's not flattered at being characterized as tricking the owners and of getting revenge, though Rachel's question is a very sensible one. Does Vea consider the fact that Shevik calls her a thing or that she is tricking and getting revenge as vulgar? Right? Wherein exactly does the vulgarity lie? Of course, Rachel, it seems to lean towards the end, right? That is what he's saying when she puts her hands over his mouth and hushes him, right? Seems to be, it's hard not to lay special emphasis on that, right? This is like the phrase that she won't let him finish, right? But nevertheless, it's a good question, Rachel, and I think an important question because we can read her resistance to him saying this stuff in a couple different ways, right? One, I mean, it could be, dude, don't let the cat out of the bag, right? Don't blow my cover. The Rosti men haven't twigged to this yet, so hush, right? That could be one way of reading it. I don't think so, though. I think she genuinely objects to what he's saying here. Because I get the impression, an impression which is in my mind very strongly reinforced by the revelation at the very end of the chapter that she is essentially a government spy, right? She's part of this whole structure, right? Which is working for the government from the beginning, right? Trying to restrain and manipulate him. And we know, their attitude towards him being distinctly profiteering, right? But anyway, even before that, she gives me the impression of very open. She's not a rebel. She's not a revolutionary. She is totally complicit. She seems genuinely content. She says she's content. He doesn't believe her because he can't imagine it. But I believe her. I believe that she's content. Yeah. Anyway, interesting. Nancy suggests that, and she says she wonders how she'd talk about this with another woman, especially another Urasti woman. I'm sure they talk about these things, but Shevik can't talk about this with her. Perhaps. Yeah. Nancy thinks the conversation they have at her house later strongly argues against her being content. I don't know. I'm gonna take a little convincing about that, Nancy, but we'll see. We'll see. Anyway, with that, I'm just gonna wreck and move on. I can't be stopped. Okay. Just a little bit later in their conversation. So you threw out all the do's and don'ts. This is now when she's pressing him about how an Aresti society works, right? And specifically talking about sexual morality and this question of possession, right? Is she a thing? Is it, you know, he's was asserting the frame, right? The Aresti frame, as sort of morally normative, right? We like people aren't possessions. And the way that you women are treated on Uris is wrong, is sort of what he was saying there, right, in that previous passage. And now she's challenging his own viewpoint. So you threw out all the do's and don'ts. But you know, I think you Odonians missed the whole point. You threw out the priests and judges and divorce laws and all that, but you kept the real trouble behind them. You just stuck it inside, into your consciences, but it's still there. You're just as much slaves as ever. You aren't really free. How do you know? I read an article in a magazine about Odonianism, she said, and we've been together all day. I don't know you, but I know some things about you. I know that you've got a Queen Taia inside you, right inside that hairy head of yours, and she orders you around just like the old tyrant did her serfs. She says, do this, and you do, and you don't. Oh, Jennifer, some of you are debating whether I'm right or not about her being a spy. Spy might be a little hard, but she's in collusion with them. She reports back. She calls her brother to tell him they're frantically looking for him because he's in fact escaped, right, and gone off into the city and they don't know where. And she calls into her brother and says, I've got him. And she keeps him all day. And they're all relieved, like, oh, phew, right? She, you know, they can track his movements, and she basically, you know, the extent of her complicity isn't explicitly said, but I don't know. My own reading of it would be that she was complicit. Yeah, no, Jennifer, I think she called earlier, not just when he was drunk and passed out. I believe the reference was she called him earlier on. So yeah, I'm pretty sure that I might be wrong about that. But anyway, it's not definite. I mean, like, we don't see her flashing a badge or something like that. It's my reading of that exchange there at the end. I think one can say very generally that she is definitely complicit with them. She's certainly not in resistance against them. She's not hiding him, for instance, right? Yeah, exactly, James. Pei and Oye. It's not Atro, it's Oye, her brother, who are at the party because she called them. Yeah, exactly. That's what leads me to believe that she called them earlier on in the day, reporting in on his movements and the fact that she had him, basically. Yeah. Anyway, okay. What was I talking about? Queen Taia, interesting society. Can you guess what my favorite phrase on this slide is? My favorite phrase is his question. How do you know? Love that. Love that. It's so perfectly Le Guin, right? Because of course it has simultaneously two completely different meanings, right? On the one hand, he's saying, how do you know? Right? You're just as much slaves as ever. You aren't really free. How do you know? Right? But what else does it mean? On the one hand, it means you don't know anything about Inaris, right? You like, shallow, superficial, stay at home. I'm wrapped up in my rich little world, Urasti woman, right? What do you know about Inaristi society? Right? You read an article in a magazine? Really? Seriously? That's it? But we could read that question a different way. Exactly, James. It could also be, who told you? How did you know? It could totally mean that as well, right? And again, this is another one of those things which comes out so much more strongly. It's like the simultaneity thing. This is chapter seven, remember. In chapter, especially in chapter 10, chapter 10 is the chapter back on Inaris when he is reunited with Takfer after the famine is over, right? And one of the things that we've seen, he has come to in chapter 10, and I don't plan to talk about chapter 10 today, so I'm going to talk about it now. But remember the stuff about Tirin. I think we're going to come back and look at this stuff more next time, but remember that stuff about Tirin, when he met Tirin, right? And the conclusion that he comes to, that he feels forced to come to, about how there are no laws in Anaresti society, but in fact there are these restrictions, right? People get shamed for doing the, Tirin broke the rules and got punished, right? As surely as if there really were laws, right? And so that conclusion, what she just said, there are these dozens, you like to consider yourself free, that you don't have any laws, and yet there are de facto laws, and you can't break them. And if you break them, you're going to be punished by the society just like everybody else, and you're punishing yourself for it, right? There's this pressure to conform, which is as strong as a law, right? That's not really come up yet fully in by chapter seven, but later on we're going to see. I know throughout chapter 10 in that section, I kept thinking of Vea and Vea's words here, right? That she seems to have more insight, perhaps, than even she understands, right? But it does seem to be a real insight. Interesting, Tom does point out that the article in the magazine seems contemporary, while what they taught at school in school on Inaris was old. Well, the magazine is contemporary, though of course it doesn't prove that their information on Odonianism is necessarily contemporary. It might be parallel, right? Just getting recirculated stuff like about Odo's time or whatever. He compares it to the word. So he's just been offended where they went to the museum, right? Where the Queen Taia's jacket made of human skin, like made of the skin of her own serfs, is preserved there, and Shevik is appalled. He's completely disgusted, right? Why do you do that? Why do you preserve that? Why do you burn it, right? Why do you celebrate your horrible history? So it's she's seizing on this because of his strong negative reaction to it, right? His indictment of the museum, right, seemed to be like basically you are cherishing the idea, Queen Taia, right? Even though, like, oh no, that doesn't happen anymore, right? Things aren't like that on Earth anymore. Well, no, but yeah, right. She is only an exaggeration of what he sees anyway, right? The relationship between the propertied and the unpropertied classes on Urus, it might as well be Queen Taia wearing the skin of her serfs, right? That's merely an exaggeration of the same principle. And so she comes back and throws that back at him, right? You have a Queen Taia in your own head, right? You are no different. You have your you carry your own dictator with you. Tom Hillman speculates, was it written in response to the coming too soon of the man in the moon? Tom, I hope that you didn't make that comment just to score points in the betting pool about the Tolkien references that I would make over the course of this class, because that would be unscrupulous. But of course, I like the reference so much that I can't resist it, even if it does swing the pool. but anyway, Rachel and Carita are both asking very similar questions. Rachel says, is it even possible to be really free? Vea doesn't appear to believe that it's possible. Carita says, what's the alternative to consciencelessness, right? I mean, that is, if the Odonians are just as much under this sort of, if basically the only, if the only two options, right, are either you serve under outward dictators or you serve under an inward dictator, right? You're under a dictator either way. So freedom, real freedom, Rachel, as you were suggesting, isn't actually possible, right? Remember what she goes on to say is, you shouldn't, he says, like, that's where she belongs. Queen Taia belongs, like, internally, right, in your conscience. And she's like, no, that's the worst place for her, right? Because if she's inside you, you can't rebel against her, right? Her power is absolute. Her authority is permanent and absolute. You could rebel against Queen Taia, right? Better to keep the authority on the outside. Better to keep the rulers outward. Better, in short, to be a thing, right? Better to be an object. Better to be marginalized and work within that system for your own benefit, right? Vea would argue, and frankly, I think she could make a really good case. And to can carry on being frank, I think that Shevik might even have to agree in the end that she makes a pretty good case. Again, especially when we come to, we don't really realize how weak some of Shevik's own defense of NRSD culture is until we get to chapter 10 and the things that we see him thinking about then. Right, and observing then, but she might be right. Vea might be more free than Shevik is. Vea on Urus might be more free, might have more real freedom than Shevik on Anaris. That's possible. I think you could make that argument. I think you could make that argument, and therefore, her statement that she is content seems to me. I'm willing to believe it. I'm not saying I'm totally convinced, but I'm willing to believe it for that reason. Nancy says she thinks it says a lot about Vea that her understanding of freedom is totally amoral. Yes, Nancy, throughout. No, you're right that she does not speak as she does not speak from within an Urasti moral or religious framework. Religion is one of those things that comes up a whole bunch of times but never really gets any play, in part because Shevik doesn't understand it. But it's used metaphorically, especially with damn and hell. Those are the two primary, those the use of those words and the desire to swear with those words. The sort of longing for blasphemy in order to, this is why I pray because it's such a bad swearing language. But anyway, that religion doesn't actually come in very much. We don't see, even though we see, we're reminded occasionally that the Urasti are practicing religion. I do think that it's really important, Nancy, that she, Vea, never at any point in this conversation says, like asserts anything dogmatically, right? She never does assert dogma. In fact, what she does do, Nancy, right, is turn that around and accuse him of dogma, right? She is not arguing based on the premise of her belief system. He is arguing on the premise of his belief system, right? And she even kind of pokes at him for that, right? Men always have their theories, right? And they don't accept things that don't fit them. Let's keep going. I'm on a roll. His response: we follow one law, only one, the law of human evolution. The law of evolution is that the strongest survives. Yes, and the strongest in the existence of any social species are those who are most social, in human terms, most ethical. You see, we have neither prey nor enemy on Inaris. We have only one another. There is no strength to be gained from hurting one another, only weakness. I don't care about hurting and not hurting. I don't care about other people, and nobody else does either. They pretend to. I don't want to pretend. I want to be free. Karita says, is it significant that Shevik wakes up with a hangover to the chapel bells? Am I overthinking that? No, Karita, you're not. As I was saying, we don't get that, there's not that much play to religion. That scene was in my head, Karita, as like one of the big exceptions I would give to what I was just saying. I do think that that's a significant moment, but even that, again, it's a very sort of indirect moment. That's significant, and I would agree with using that observation towards larger conclusions about about Uras and religion. But the point that I was making still stands about the fact that we don't, and certainly not with Thea, we don't get dogma from them. Very few people are saying, but this is what's right because God says so, or something like that. That's just not a thing. I don't remember any of the Urasti talking like that, even though, again, theoretically, religion is supposed to be a big thing. Anyway, okay. So, what is she asserting? Define freedom here. Anarchy, says Kristen. I like that, Kristen. Yeah, anarchy. Having no rules, right? And if you have to pretend something, then you're following a rule, right? You're obeying the Queen Taia in your head or the Queen Taia in your society, like they do on Inaris, right? Like Tirin, like what messed Tirin up, right? Freedom means doing whatever you want to do, right? They don't do that on Inaris. Think from the very beginning, right? People are constantly getting rebuked on Inaris. And again, we talked about the human nature thing last time. Stop egoizing. It's what they say on Inaris, right? Well, they wouldn't have to, just as, Tom, just as you were pointing out earlier, Takfir wouldn't have the concept of a body profiteer if there were no women who are body profiteers on Inaris, right? So too, people wouldn't have to keep saying stop egoizing if people weren't egoizing, right? But the really important thing is that they're still saying it, right? They're attempting to compel compliance to this restriction, right? To this concept. In other words, in Vea's terms, they're not free, right? So Vea and Bunub both agree that Inaris is not a free society for very different reasons, right? Yeah, and James, of course, exactly. And she doesn't even make this argument, right? James says, on Uruk, some people definitely gain from hurting others. Exactly. He's trying to state this kind of. Remember when he was. Oh, I forget which physicist it was. Was it Oye? I think it was Oye, who talked about all those idealists up on. No, it was Atro, I think. It was Atro, who talked about those idealists up on the moon. And he's like, I don't think there are many idealists left on Anaris, right? And yet, what he's just been saying, idealism sounds is exactly what that sounds like, right? There is no strength to be gained from hurting one another, only weakness. Really? Right, Tom, that's exactly what I was about to say. Didn't Sobble gain by hurting others? Yes, exactly. That's an idealistic statement. Of course, people can gain things, profit by hurting others, right? You can argue that societally speaking, like Sobble is a didn't Shevik use the word psychopath to describe Sobble, not just as an insult. It was when he was talking about it was when he was comparing this, you know, what was he was right. It was when he was noticing that the notes he was taking, when he was taking deliberately small cryptic notes as he was working out the theory, his notes looked just like Sobble's notes, right? And he sort of observes that what was psychopathy, I think is the noun form that she uses. What was psychopathy on Anaris is, you know, just prudence on Uris. Anyway, so he's sort of his actions, Sobble's attitudes and proprietarian and profiteering actions are not a gain for the society as a whole. They weaken the society as a whole, they could argue, right? But remember when they keep coming back in their debates on Anaris? Well, I'm thinking about the debate that Shevik and Tiran had back in chapter 2. I'm thinking about the debate that they had on the night of the party when he was leaving the Institute. I'm thinking of exchanges that he even exchanges that he has with Sobble when Sobble is being an Odo-citer, right? Anyway, the word that keeps coming up is functional, right? It's not functional. Isn't it though? Doesn't it function? That is to say, I mean, you could argue that Sobble's profiteering attitude, it certainly functions for him. You could argue that it's not optimally functional for the society, I guess. Maybe, but it's it's not obvious. It's not 100% obvious that that's the case, you know, that it's actually not functioning. They might be right, and I'm not sure that she isn't right. Certainly our own experience in SD culture in the even numbered chapters, I think, lends to doubt, right? Here's Shevik sarcastically characterizing sarcastically characterizing Anaris. Now there are these two passages that I want to put side by side with each other, right? This one and the one later at the party. So we have this thing that he says, clearly joking, right? As sort of evidently sarcastic. And then the statement that he makes when he's drunk later on at the party. So I want to put those two passages side by side. You are right, Shevik said. No fun, Never. All day long on Anaris, we dig lead in the bowels of the mines, and when night comes, after our meal of the three hollum grain soaked in one spoonful of brackish water, we antiphonally recite the sayings of Odo until it is time to go to bed, which we all do separately, and wearing boots. Okay, so there's his... So you see what he is doing is sarcastically parodying the Urasti viewpoint on Anaris, right? The Urasti perception of Anaris, right? This seems to be what he's making fun of. Now let's go right on. I'll talk about both of these passages at once. Here's his outburst at the party. Something dark turned over in Shevik's mind, darkening everything. His mouth was dry. He finished the glassful the waiter had just poured him. I don't know, he said, his tongue felt half paralyzed. No, it is not wonderful. It is an ugly world. Not like this one. Anaris is all dusty and dry hills, all meager, all dry. And the people aren't beautiful. They have big hands and feet, like me and the waiter there, but not big bellies. They get very dirty and take baths together. Nobody here does that. The towns are very small and dull. They are dreary. No palaces. Life is dull and hard work. You can't always have what you want, or even what you need, because there isn't enough. You Urasti have enough. Enough air, enough rain, grass, oceans, food, music, buildings, factories, machines, books, clothes, history. You are rich. You own. We are poor. We lack. You have. We do not have. Everything is beautiful here, only not the faces. On Anaris, nothing is beautiful, nothing but the faces. The other faces, the men and women, we have nothing but that, nothing but each other. Here you see the jewels, there you see the eyes. And in the eyes you see the splendor of the human spirit, because our men and women are free. Possessing nothing, they are free. And you, the possessors, are possessed. You are all in jail. Each one, each alone, solitary, with a heap of what he owns. You live in prison, die in prison. It is all I can see in your eyes. The wall. The wall. So that passage pretty much tips the recurring motif, you know, meter way off the scale, right? Yana, it's the first passage you were referring to, right? Yana is suspecting that that for his first sarcastic characterization of Anaresti society is probably not that far off from the article that Thea read, right? Perhaps. So at the very least, I would say it seems to be his intention to parody such accounts as he assumes she probably has read. Though remember, the article was about Odonianism in general, not about Anaresti culture exactly, but still, yeah. Nancy, I too am interested in the fact that he identifies history as something that they have enough of on Urus. They don't have enough history on Anaris, right? And it's true. It's a short term place, right? It's been it's only 150 years old. The whole society, right? Yeah, good. Okay. More. What do you know? Sometimes I can predict the passages which are going to elicit few comments. I was guessing this was going to be. There's so much here. It's really hard to start. Karita, I agree. On Anaris, nothing is beautiful, nothing but the faces is a great line. Tom Hillman suggests that he's in denial. Perhaps. Okay, first, let's back up a step even from that. In this moment, in this speech, how do we characterize this speech? That is, is he being honest? He's drunk, right? And we see him throwing back his last drink here at the beginning of this paragraph, right? Shevik is drunk. He is blurting this out inappropriately, right? Is this honesty? Are we getting are is he's drunk, so that does that mean that his like filters are down, like his own shields are down? This is him just saying what he feels about Inaris. That's the first impression it gives to me, especially given the fact that the way that he begins, right? This comes when somebody just asks him, like, so, like, tell us about your home, tell us about your planet. It's like an opportunity for him to gush about Inaris. It seems to be almost even what they want, right? Him to do. And in so when instead he says, it's not wonderful, it's an ugly world, right? The impression that it gives is of him opening up, right, about a shameful thing, right? Okay, I can't deny it, right? Normally, if I were sober, I wouldn't say these things, right? I would try to hide it. I would say, oh yeah, so he's yeah, it's awesome. Inaris is awesome, right? But so here's him, like, this is the stark truth about what he really thinks. But does the whole speech sound that way? Is it fair for us? Does this mean that this is really the rock bottom of his perspective? I'm less sure that that sticks with it all the way through. James, you're right. That's exactly what it sounds like. It's a great metaphor. James says it sounds like he's had these thoughts, sort of penned up, and they all come dumping out now like a truckload of bricks. Yeah, that's exactly what this sounds like. Both that sort of the length, the inappropriate, like the socially inappropriateness of this speech. I mean, it sounds like this is all just bursting out of him, like he's been holding this back and it's all coming out. I think that's true. But, and Kristen, that's a great observation. Kristen points out it sounds like he's describing Inaris from an Erastes set of eyes too, at least for the first half. Yeah, Kristen, I would say that at least he knows the Erastes well enough now to know what they would say if they looked at it, right? Or rather, having been immersed in Erastes society, or at least the property to Erastes society, now looking back at Inaris, he himself looks at it with different eyes, right? He realizes how meager and dry it is. You don't really appreciate the meagerness and dryness until you're surrounded. I mean, remember how alien it was just for him to stand on grass, right? In that, like, by the Odo statue, the first time he goes to Abinai. Anyway, so all this does seem to kind of, it's like the pot boiling over, right? To use a different metaphor. But I don't think that necessarily proves that these are his bedrock true beliefs. And I say this especially. It's another one of those things that gets changed for me. The apparent stark honesty of the earlier, like Inaris is dull and hard work and ugly, and it's, but Urus is so much better in so many ways. The fact that he leads with that seems to give more strength to his final assertions, right? Our men and women are free, possessing nothing, they are free, and you, the possessors, are possessed. You are all in jail. Again, reading this book for the first time, I'm like, yeah, that's it. There it is, right? This is what he. This, and of course he's using the term possessed, right? So of course throughout the book I've been like primed to look for possessed or dispossessed from the title. So, I'm like, okay, here it is, right? There's the whole meat of it. But of course, reading it through for the second time, I'm remembering chapter 10, right? And the conclusions that he comes to on Inaris prior to this, that the Anaresti are not completely free again. Like, that is kind of right. about the Queen Taia that they carry around in their heads, and that even sort of rules their society, right? This sort of collective Queen Taia of the social expectations on an Ars, restrict them. Can he really say that men and women are free on an Ars and beautiful, like their faces are beautiful if everything else is ugly? You are in jail. You are alone and solitary. You live in prison. What about Tirin? Doesn't Tirin live in a prison? Right? Whether it was a prison of his own making, there's the question of, like, did he volunteer to go to the asylum? Right? We don't know for sure whether he did or not. And does it matter if he did or not? Right? So you see, here's the way that chapter 10 works on me here. It's not just Shevik, you couldn't prove that, right? That would be bad enough. What's worse is seeing chapter 10 and coming back and saying, Shevik, do you even believe this? Are you for real? I know you don't believe that, or at least you haven't always believed that, right? As we get closer and closer in the NRST chapters of the book, the NRST chapters are getting closer and closer and closer to chapter one, right? Closer and closer to the time of his departure for Uris. And the closer we get, the more disillusioned he is becoming, the less convinced he is that the NRST are free, right? Remember chapter two. In chapter two, the juxtaposition of his departure on the spaceship to go to Uris in chapter one with the argument that with Tirin that teenage Shevik had in chapter two, right? Where Tirin was saying, we should be able to go to Uris. We should want to go to Uris. If our society is in fact superior, we should want to go and, proselytize for their good. We should share, right? We're not sharing. Why are we not sharing? Why are we NRST being proprietarian about this? We should want to share. And he's like, oh, go to Uris. Oh, that's appalling. And when we're reading chapter two, right, it's really easy to be like, I am a cunning, savvy reader, right? I see just what's going on here, right? We see Shevik saying, no, going to Uris is terrible, but we already know he is going to go to Uris. And so the implication, like the dramatic irony of that passage, would seem to suggest that Shevik is going to come around to Tirin's point of view, right? He might be saying now, no, I'm not going to, but now he is in fact doing that, right? So he's going to sort of share Odonianism with, or so he's gonna have a he's gonna have like a some kind of like kind of whatever a conversion experience over the course of the rest of his life, and then as we go through and read it, we find no, that's not what happens actually. It's not a conversion to proselytizing Odonianism. It's not about sharing with Urus. When he goes to Urus, the further we get, the more we discover that. When he goes to Uris, it's not his sort of confidence in Odonianism and NRST society, and from which he is reaching out to the Urasti. That's not the situation at all, right? His own confidence in NRST society, in Odonianism to some extent, in NRST society, and to a much greater extent, is low and decreasing, right? As time goes on, still decreasing. To the point that we've read for today. So you are all in jail. You live in prison. I, of course, can't help but re especially I can't help but remember here, chapter one, right? Is the wall enclosing the airfield, or is the wall enclosing the whole planet, right? He's saying you are locked up in prison, but of course, as he said to the doctor back in chapter one, locking in, locking out, what's the difference, right? They're all in jail. They're all in jail. And if each person is locked into a solitary prison, everyone else is locked up, right? Again, like the airfield. And then, of course, he reinforces this idea with this reference to the wall. That's all I can see in your eyes, the wall. The wall. That is the thing that seems to me most honest, the most sort of fully honest with himself, most genuine element of this entire outpouring is his reference to the wall, because it's the one thing he says that nobody in the crowd can possibly understand, right? It's a purely personal, they don't know about his dream, about the wall and what that means to him, right? There, for the first time, he's clearly talking to himself, right? He's not talking to them. He's not sort of trying to convince himself of something. He's acknowledging that he's coming up against that in their eyes, right? But again, the wall has two sides. It's like the prison and the locking of the prison door. When they're talking about the war in Benbili, remember, between Thu and Ayo. The politics of reality, that's what how Oye characterized the political situation, right? About the, their choice to go to war and everything. The politics of reality, Shevik repeated. He looked at Oye and said, "That is a curious phrase for a physicist to use." "Not at all. The politician and the physicist both deal with things as they are, with real forces, the basic laws of the world. You put your petty, miserable laws to protect wealth, your forces of guns and bombs, in the same sentence with the law of entropy and the force of gravity? I had thought better of your mind, Demare." The politics of reality, right? Because, of course, that's one of the big questions here, right? What is reality? What is real? The politics of reality. He chides Oye here, right? Your horrible Urasti politics, right, are not objective reality, right? That is how you're choosing. So, when he says, "I thought better of your mind," what he's accusing him of, right, is a false parallel. The law of entropy and the force of gravity, those are objective things, he's is arguing, right? The basic laws of the world. Those are facts external to any human theory or belief, right? You can make theories about them, but they're things on their own. What the politician does, Shevik argues, is totally, fundamentally different from what the physicist does, right? Because with the politician, it's entirely based on their societal principles, which he finds abhorrent, right? Your laws to protect wealth, and notice even sort of the implication there, the assumption or the law that wealth must be protected, right? Again, your whole diseased society point of view, right? For you to claim that those are parallel to the law of entropy, right? That those are independently existing realities that you can take for granted. He just finds not only clearly ethically abhorrent, but also intellectually sloppy, right? You are not acknowledging how many of your own laws and, your own military forces, right? How subjective, non-objective those things are, right? But I was really struck by this phrase, the politics of reality, because it's one way to really think through a bunch of the things that we've been looking at and talking. What is real in the end, right? Coming back to the phrase that we were talking to Rachel, I remember you emphasizing this in an earlier comment, what's real freedom, right? What is real freedom? what are the politics of reality? Is that what we just got from Shevik? I mean, is that what this is, right? Again, reality unfiltered. I don't think so, not entirely. So what is, where what are the politics of reality? So Shevik accuses Oye of being blind and sloppy, right, comparing politics and physics. But doesn't Shevik suggest that that is the case, right? Again, it's not. He says you put your petty, miserable laws to protect wealth, right? In the same sentence with the law of entropy. But that's him, that's Shevik sitting in judgment upon their petty, miserable laws, right? Or on their laws to protect wealth and finding them both petty and miserable, as well as, he hates the idea of law and punishment anyway, right? So I think that's why he puts laws in quotation marks. It's not a real law, right? It's just something you decree, right? A real law is a description of how things really are and how things really work. But is his own, what is the po if okay, assuming he's right, that Iade politics is not the politics of reality, what is the politics of reality? Where lie the politics of reality? It's not Anaresti politics, right? Is Odonianism the politics of reality? Well, our own, what we've seen on Inaris suggests no, not really. And yet there does seem to be this grasping towards an idea of reality, right? Now, Tom, I agree with you. There's a fundamental, there's like a metaphorical gap here, right? As Tom points out, physical laws are descriptive, human laws are prescriptive. That's true. And Tom, it's something that I find peculiar. It makes me think of a passage in, I think it's the Discarded Image, where C.S. Lewis talks about the sort of the oddity. He kind of draws attention to that metaphor, right? The fact that modern people talk about the laws of nature, which is kind of peculiar, actually, because it sort of implies that like who passed the law of gravity, right? Is there a lawgiver, right? It seems to be, that whole concept seems to be rooted in, the cultural past, which believed in a lawgiver for the laws of nature, right? That these were God's laws. But yet we've, so even though, science has separated itself from that kind of thinking, we still employ that kind of language. But Tom, your larger point is right as well, right? That there's the entire metaphor breaks down when you think about it. And that to me seems a really important thing, right? The whole question, like, so what is reality? What is the concept of reality then? What do we even mean by that? Tom, I guess I would say, when thinking about like politics, thinking about Odonianism and Erasti society and everything, should it be descriptive or prescriptive, right? What's the right approach? How do we understand? How can we be truly free? In a sense, right, that seems to be one of the terms of the between Veya and Shevik, right? Veya says that it's an Erasti society which is being prescriptive, overly prescriptive. Right? No, they don't have laws technically, right? But they have all these inhibitions. Even as they themselves feel that it's the Iyati, right, who are it's the Iyati who are repressed and not open and honest about all of these things. So look at that, people. Not only have I gotten through, what am I on? Seven so far, and I'm not done yet. I still got 15 minutes here. But I even got to the slide that contains the title of the class, which is always like the sort of touchstone, right, of my progress on the slides. If I don't even get anywhere close to the concept or the passage from which I took the title of the class, that's when you know things are not going well. Anyway, okay, all right. We're still going. He thought as he sat in the train of trying to get out of AIO. I don't even know how to say that. No consonants. I need consonants. Iotic, I find very difficult to say. IEO? It's like, how many syllables do you think? Two? Like IEO? Or three? IEO? IEO? I don't know. There, whatever. Of going to Ben Billy, maybe. But he did not take the thought seriously. He would have to ride on a ship or airplane. He would be traced and stopped. The only place where he could get out of sight of his benevolent and protective hosts was in their own big city, under their noses. It was not an escape. Even if he did get out of the country, he would still be locked in Urus. You couldn't call that escape, whatever the archists, with their mystique of national boundaries, might call it. But he suddenly felt cheerful, as he had not for days, when he thought that his benevolent and protective hosts might think, for a moment, that he had escaped. This is, of course, the beginning of the day when he goes off, which he ends up spending with Bea, and which, by the way, did you notice in Chapter 9, turns out to have also cunningly removed all of his pocket cash, right? He's left with almost no money after this day. Does that prove that that was Vea's plan all along, right? Not this doesn't prove it, right? But it is kind of interesting, right? That he ends up being much more helpless later on because Vea kind of took all his money, essentially. Karina thinks AO should rhyme with Deo, like the song. Yeah. I can get into that, Karina. It works for me. Anyway, okay. My primary interest in this passage at this moment is metaphorical, right? For me, this passage is kind of like planted the seed, right? No, I'm not going to sing it, Tom. I'm getting distracted, Karina, thinking about the song, which I'm not singing. No, it's all good. Metaphorical. Okay. Just this, it's like this passage is like a seed planted, right? He wants to escape. But he knows he can't escape, right? He can't escape. He can look like he's escaping, but he's not really escaping, right? And I wanted to bring this in this context, because to me it really relates to this question of reality, right? And this think even of the implications for the NRSC colony as a whole, right? They escaped, right? They are their own people. They are on their own planet. They have their own society. They are free. They are free of their Urasti masters, right? And not entirely, right? We see one sense in which the NRSC are not as free as they kind of like to think of themselves early on, right? As Shevik is aware of the political situation, that in fact Urus uses Anaris as a mining colony, right? The Anarasti colony is ultimately a profiteering move by the Urasti, right? So there's that one sense already from the beginning in which Inaris is not actually as independent as it likes to think that it is. But of course, as we move forward and think about Vea's accusation with the Queen Taia in their heads, right? Is there a larger sense in which, as well, they are not free, right? They are not actually. You can he can get out of his rooms, right? And the his bugged chambers, right? He can get off campus. He can get out into the city on his own, but it's not really an escape, right? He could leave the country. He could go to Ben Billy, but that wouldn't be an escape either. He's still locked in, right? Locked in Uris. Is all of Inaris still really locked in Uris? What are really the politics of reality? Let's look at his relationship. Well, maybe we shouldn't. This starts kind of not exactly a new topic, but sort of an arc that we're not going to quite get to the end of. I know what we can do. Let's jump ahead a little. We'll come back and talk about this passage again in relationship to Shevik's relationship with the rebels in Neo. But I wanna finish our conversation about Vea and come back to that other really uncomfortable thing, and finish that, and then we'll come back to the rebels next time. So this is Shevik the morning after waking up with a hangover. He saw now, in detail, item by item from the beginning, that he had made a mistake in coming to Uris, his first big mistake, and one that was likely to last him the rest of his life. Once he had seen it, once he had rehearsed all the evidences of it that he had suppressed and denied for months, and it took him a long time, sitting there motionless at his desk, until he had arrived at the ludicrous and abominable last scene with Vea, and had lived through that again too, and felt his face go hot until his ears sang, then he was done with it. Even in this post-alcoholic veil of tears, he felt no guilt. That was all done now, and what must be thought about was, what must he do now? Having locked himself in jail, how might he act as a free man? Now, again, all this stuff very relevant to the bigger political question and his own freedom and all that other stuff. I want to come back to this sex and gender thing and finish that up. Well, finish that up. I want to come back to that again here. His reflection upon the ludicrous and abominable last scene with Vea, namely his sexual assault of Vea, and we might as well call it that, right? His attempt to force himself upon her, the scene which culminates with his ejaculation of his semen all over her dress, right? Which has this like hideous similarity to think about like possession. Right, he objectifies her, right? He believes that she is inviting him, right? He loses all of his inhibition, he loses control, he is drunk, right? But he loses control, he treats her ultimately like an object, right? He disregards even her protests and the thing that she's saving him, she's pushing back against him, right? She's trying to push him off playfully, flirtatiously at first, right? Okay, but not now, not now, not now, she keeps saying, right? I'm not saying no, right? I'm just saying not now. And then she's finally pushing him, trying to push him back with all of her strength, right? And still he won't go, right? And he still insists and he forces himself upon her like a proprietarian, right? Now, let me make a general apology before I go any further in talking about this. This is a really intense scene, and I know that there are many people for whom this is a really, really personal issue. And I hope, I really hope that you will believe me, that I'm not trying to make light of that or make jokes about that or belittle any issue involved with sexual assault. But what I am going to do and going to try to do here anyway is the thing I always have always told my students to do, often in English classes, in undergraduate English classes. We'd get to a pass something like this, where students, again, not all students, not all the time, but where sometimes people, where there's that tendency to react first and analyze second, basically, right? To say, like, I am appalled by this. And what I always say, and it's not always fun, the first thing, if you're gonna try to read and understand anybody else really, but to understand a story here, you have to put yourself within it first. You have to open yourself up to it. It might be painful and horrible. I often find it so myself. But you've got to see what it take it on its own terms first to understand what the story is really doing and saying. Then, once you've drawn your conclusions, you're very free to find it appalling and reject it, right? You're like that, so you're free to hate the book, right, after you understand it, or it. But what I always insist on, even though I say as many times it's kind of a painful duty, is first to set that aside, not to let your own strong negative reaction to things get in the way of you understanding a term. So understanding the terms of the text, understanding the text itself. This is why, by the way, this is the primary reason why when I dislike books, this is one of the main reasons that I dislike them, right? Okay, I'll get ad hominem. This is part of the reason why I s dislike the George R. R. Martin books, why I cannot love Game of Thrones and the whole Song of Ice and Fire series. Because when I enter into that world, I find myself put in places that I hate being imaginatively. And when I emerge from it, right, when I, and I don't just mean like an experience of being carried away, imaginatively carried away by the secondary world, though that happens too. Goodness knows, Martin is a wonderful writer, and that happens very, very strongly. But even in thinking about it and analyzing it, like just again trying to understand it on its own terms, I find its own terms personally repellent at many points. And it's I don't want to live there. I don't like it, and so I don't want to go back, and I don't want to reread it, and I don't enjoy it. I admire it. So many things about it I admire. He's a marvelous writer. He's an incredible world builder. I don't enjoy his books, and that's why I don't enjoy them, right? Anyway, this is all a roundabout way of setting up this issue. Like again, I hope that you won't think anything that I say about this is attempting to take the issue of sexual assault lightly or to make jokes about it. But I am trying to understand it within the framework of this story. To understand it within the terms that we're given here, right? Within the terms of this story, how I understand Shevik's action there of sexual assault. The thing that is one of the things that's so appalling about it, again, within the frame, is that he is acting in such a blatantly proprietarian way. I've called Shevik a good Odonian, right? One of the best of the Odonians. We see him being a much more consistently Odonian thinker than most of the aneresti that we meet, right? And in this moment, he is not only betraying the relationship he has with Vea, right? The friendship, the camaraderie that he had with her, the respect that he has shown for her. He is betraying that by now treating her like an object, right? He is acting like this is him, this moment, right? When Shevik is sexually assaulting Vea, this is his low point within the terms of the book, clearly, right? Clearly his low point because he is, doing to her exactly what he was objecting to Urasti society doing to her, right? He is treating her like the Urasti treat women, right? He has objectified her completely. He does not treat her like a human being, right? Remember that phrase that we were looking at before, back in slide one, seems chilling in retrospect, right? She was so ostentatiously a female body that it was hard to treat her like a human being, right? And in the end, he sees her only as a female body, and does not treat her like a human being. Remember, rape is one of the things in an Anarchist society. It's one of the biggest no-nos, right, of Anarchist society. No laws, right? But rape, murder, and being the good, yeah, several of you were just alluding to this. It's one of the things you get in the asylum for, right? Being a rapist. Now, good. Several of you are bringing up the question of the alcohol, and I agree. I believe that that's a really important thing here. Brian Dimmick asks, what are we to make of the effect of the alcohol? If alcohol lowers inhibitions, are even anarchists naturally proprietarian when their socially created inhibitions are removed? Brian, it reminds me of things that are said twice by anarchists about women and pregnancy, women and children. Right? Remember, there's that one really crass guy from the Dust who says that women are all profiteers, it's the kids, right? They're all proprietarians, women are. And Tocqueville, when she's talking about the effect of pregnancy, right? That pregnancy makes you a profiteer. Anyway, but totally irresponsible of me to bring in lots of passages like that and then be like, but let's not think about those carefully. Anyway, so, but Brian, I'm kind of, this is all relevant to your point about the question of even NRST being naturally proprietarian. My point is merely we have some other data points about that, right? To suggest, again, as I was suggesting last time about human nature, does it suggest that that is proprietarianism in fact the politics of reality? Is Shevik wrong, right? Of course, we can't forget the juxtaposition. He has just made his speech about freedom and how they're not free and how beautiful are the faces of the interesting. That's immediately before the attempted rape, right? Immediately before the sexual assault. It's important to keep that in mind. Hey, I have an idea. Let's go back to the passage before us. And Karita, you brought this up, and you're very right to bring this up. Sort of wondering what exactly we're supposed to do with this passage. He lives through it again, the ludicrous and abominable last scene with Vea, and felt his face go hot until his ears sang, then he was done with it. Even in his post-alcoholic veil of tears, he felt no guilt. And Karita's very excellent question, why? Why doesn't he feel guilt? Shouldn't he feel guilt for how he treated Van? Is it an interesting thing, not to feel guilt. Don't think so. I mean, again, rape is one of those things that you're supposed to feel guilty about, right? In fact, remember, Karita, you don't get sent to the asylum, right? You go. You request a posting at the asylum, right? And it's guilt, probably, that would lead to that, right? Shame. Let me go to the last and most uncomfortable place. Vea embraces being objectified. Right? You see why I'm uncomfortable talking about this? Because doesn't this sound horribly like I'm about to talk about how Vea was asking to be sexually assaulted, right? If she hadn't been dressed so provocatively, how could he restrain himself, especially when he was drunk, right? I mean, I know that's what it sounds like. Forget our world, right? Forget any horrible court cases that might come to mind or anything like that. Focus on the text. Vea, I believe, as I said before, I believe does embrace being objectified. And she embraces it because she finds in that action, the action of embracing her objectification, she finds true freedom. She argues she can do whatever she wants. Because so she is complicit. Whether or not she's complicit with the government and the spies, I think she is, but whether or not she is, she is clearly complicit with the provocation. Even if we are seeing her and the descriptions of how provocatively she is dressed and acting through a lens of Shevik's own desire, there is no question that she is deliberately provocative. Clearly, she is. She says, why is she content? Because she has power. Because her provocation gives her power. She, how do women on or in on Urus, how do they why are they content? Why don't they rebel? Because they don't need to rebel, she says, right? They have power. Remember again Takhver's expression about a body profiteer. That a woman who acts that way is profiteering. She is seeking an end, seeking power for herself. She is using the man's desire for her as a means to empower herself. Therefore, the text presents Vea's situation as a paradoxical one, right? On the one hand, completely marginalized, totally objectified, not a human being, but a mere object of desire, right? An instrument for the pleasure, be it actual sexual pleasure or merely like more abstract titillation, right? Of men, right? But on the other hand, so she's powerless. And yet she's powerful, right? It is that manipulation of desire. She's also a profiteer. She's profiting from this. Remember when Shevik is trying to figure out, he has that moment where he is asking the question, is she a prostitute? He doesn't really understand prostitution, but he doesn't think she's a prostitute, right? That he doesn't think that would be it would be fair to characterize her as a prostitute. Because prostitutes are like not like that, right? But a prostitute is a profiteer, right? Using sex as a means to acquire wealth. Now, again, he knows that it's not like prostitutes are rich, happy people, right? They're not wealthy. They're not happy. They're not satisfied. They're not rich, right? But again, that abstract concept, divorced of the reality, like again, how real prostitutes live and what real prostitutes are like based upon what he's heard in Oris and what he learned back in school, right? But divorced from that, the mere concept of prostitution is about profiteering, right? Is about selling a thing which Ananaris is shared. Remember the gift that was given to him by that first woman, right? In the desert. We looked at, remember, it seems like 8 years ago that we talked about that? One thing that would seem pretty clear is that he calls the scene abominable, that last scene with Vea. Presumably, Vea would consider it abominable too, but for different reasons, I bet, right? Both to Shevek and to Vea, what he does is abominable. But again, I think they're abominable differently. It's abominable to him because he has descended to the lowest level of proprietarianism, right? Rapists are like down there with murderers, right? You cannot act more. You cannot more greatly deviate from that. So, you remember the more social, the more beneficial, right? The brotherhood, or you cannot violate the principle of brotherhood more radically than by rape or murder, right? To Vea, he clearly would have. It would be abominable as well. But, and again, this seems so horrible to say, but in the patterns of the text, what it suggests to me is that the category that Vea would put it in, what Shevik does, right, trying to force himself upon her and in the end ejaculating on her dress, of the vulgarity that she puts her fingers on his lips to stop, right? It's when he begins to violate her, right? She kisses him. She initiates the kiss, which is clearly just a piece of flirtation, right? And he takes it as an invitation. Right, he thinks that that's what she wants, that she's offering to copulate with him. I'm not trying to justify Shevik and say that like what he did in his own eyes was right. It's not. He calls it abominable himself, right? But anyway, she initiates that, and it's from her initial words. One way it seems to me that you can characterize her initial reaction is not this way. Right, not now. She could, like, you're doing it wrong. It isn't that your sexual advances are totally inappropriate or unwanted, right? It's just this isn't how it's done. You can't just pounce on me, right? You can't mess up my. This is my party, right? You can't mess up my dress. You can't. I have to take contraceptives. We have to. Take it's not this is not just an open sharing, right? Again, I know it sounds like a potentially horrible thing. It sounds as if I'm saying, really, his sexual assault was only bad because it was vulgar, right? But again, I hope you see can see the patterns that I'm saying, and I'm trying to differentiate what makes it abominable from Shevik's point of view, and what might make it abominable from Vea's point of view, based on what we see her doing and saying in the text. And again, you can decide later whether you think that's okay or not. You can decide what you think of Le Guin's depiction of, women and the whole sexual assault issue here, on your own later on. I'm just trying to sort out the patterns of what we can see there in the text. So, what's happening there, and how does it fit in? I also can't forget. I also can't forget the parallel scene that immediately happens. So remember, after this, right? After the sexual assault is done, right? She takes him back out again. He's staggering around drunk. She takes him out. And remember what he does? He comes to the food tray and vomits on the food tray. Now, I can't escape the parallel between his ejaculating on her dress, his ejaculating on her very sexually provocative dress, right? And his vomiting on the deliciously enticing pastries, right? That's clearly a matched set there, right? But it's not the same thing either, right? The dynamics are not the same. The one is, well, no, it is parallel. I'm sorry. I was going to say the because the one is a reaching out of his desire towards her, whereas the other is a rejection, right? He's puking up all the food and drink and alcohol that he. I mean, it's ultimately the alcohol, right? He's getting alcohol poisoning. That's why he's puking, but presumably, but it's also the food that he eight, as he emphasized in this right in this passage here that's on the screen, not in this very passage, but I don't think no, right around it, within a paragraph or two, all the bread that he ate on that he's eaten on Urus, it says. Okay, anyway, so I was I, so my first thought was that they were opposites in a sense of each other. That is him. Giving in to the desire for the one on the other, on the one hand, and his rejection, like his body spewing back up the other on the other side. But then I was realizing, no, actually, they aren't the same, right? Why is he puking onto the tray? Because he indulged in it before, right? Because he did, just as he has given into, and again, I know the potential horrible sounding of this, but he is falling in line with Vea, right? That is, again, she is complicit in the provocation. She has argued that it is in that provocation that women have power. They have power over men, right? Are men objectifying them and not treating them like human beings? Yes, but nobody treats anybody like human beings. She herself said nobody really cares about hurting other people or not hurting other people. Nobody cares, right? Everyone is about themselves ultimately, and she can profit by the provocation. She can get what she wants, and we see her throughout the day getting what she wants, right? She makes Shevik pay for everything, and it's one small example, right? Anyway, so in a sense, forgive me for saying it, in a sense she is getting what she is. She you could also say she has Shevik completely in her power here, right? Doing what he's like supposed to do, almost, right? He is complying with her. He is complying with the Eraasti system, with the whole eotic worldview. And that's what it has in common with the bread and the alcohol, I think I would say. Right? He was indulging himself. He was living on off the fat of the land, like a filthy profiteer, right? I think I'm going to leave it there. I might come back and try to draw some more general conclusions of this next time. And as I say, we'll read this passage again next week in the context of looking at Shevik and his time with the revolutionaries there in Urus. But anyway, I am thank you for coming with me on this very uncomfortable. This is by far the most uncomfortable part of the book for me. Like I said, I find that my experience, by the way, of reading this isn't like George R. R. Martin. I don't feel like I'm being made complicit with horrible actions or horrible points of view. But I do feel uncomfortable about the way in which Le Guin is. I feel Le Guin is almost compelling me as a reader not to become emotionally and psychologically complicit in the horrible action that Shevik commits, but to look at the situation with a degree of dispassion that makes me uncomfortable, right? Everything in me wants to just be appalled, right? And to exculpate Vea, right? Saying that Vea's getting what she's asking for is like the most horrible. My mind shudders back from saying that, but I do feel that that's where the book is pushing us, right? And it seems to me what just as think about all of the uncomfortable. This is just one uncomfortable thing, or this happens to be a thing that makes a lot of this is a particularly sensitive thing for our society just now, right? But to me, it's of a piece with what we see Le Guin doing throughout this work, right? Forcing us to kind of compare and think dispassionately from both sides, right? Looking at both sides of the wall. And anyway, I find the experience desperately uncomfortable. But again, kind of a piece, although this is a more sensitive point, of a piece with the way that she does in other places and stuff. Anyway, so there we are. We'll come back to the revolutions next time. We'll talk about Tirin next time. We may even talk about the general temporal theory next time. But we'll see. No promises. All right. Thanks, everybody. Good night. I will see you guys next week. Don't forget about the webathon on Saturday, 11 a.m. To 9 p.m. I hope you'll be able to join me for some or all of the webathon. It should be a lot of fun. Do follow that link to find their different registration links for the different things, so that I do hope that that you'll be able to join me for bits of it. I look forward to it. Thanks, everybody. Good night. Bye now.